हेलो फोक्स, वेलकम बैक टू द रुपीडिया वर्ल्ड एंड आई एम अभिनय गुप्ता। सो टुडे अगेन वी विल बी कंटिन्यूइंग विद द वाइंडिंग अप ऑफ द कंपनीज फॉलोइंग द प्रोविजंस ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट 1956, राइट। सो फार वी हैव कवर्ड अ लॉट ऑफ लेक्चर्स ऑन वाइंडिंग अप, राइट। आई होप यू आर थॉरो थ्रू इट, यू नो द कंसेप्ट्स वेरी वेल एंड यू नाउ गेट द फीलिंग ऑफ हाउ द वाइंडिंग अप इज बीइंग कंडक्टेड, राइट। सो फार वी हैव अंडरस्टूड वॉट इज द सिचुएशन ऑफ द कंपनी, how does the winding up initiate, whether it is the compulsory winding up, the voluntary winding up by members, by creditors, or winding up by supervision of the court, right? You know that, yes, the liquidator comes. What is the process of the liquidator that is follows? The liquidator sells off the assets, arranges for all the cash, all the liquid money that it has, and then pays off all the liabilities, the debts to the creditors, to bank, to the financial institutions, whatever are there, right? That is basically what the liquidator does, settles the assets and liabilities, and when it is finally settled, the company is dissolved. Okay, we have seen that. We have also seen who the contributors are, who the creditors are, and what is a defunct company, what happens after dissolution, how can the name be recovered and stuff. But there is one important essence of winding up, right, and which is also very important from your examination point of view, is that the list of the people whom you need to pay. What order do you need to follow when you are making the payment for the liabilities and the creditors, right? So your order of payment, right, that is one of the most important aspect that is yet to be covered, right? So today's lecture will be specifically based on that, but we will not complete it in the lecture itself. We'll take one or two lectures on this topic because one, it is a very important topic. Two, you need to seep it down in your head. Because if you ask me for the list, I can just narrate it. Okay, this, then this, and this, and it's over, right? And you can also maybe memorize it, not a big deal, but understand, you have hell lot of things to memorize. If you are appearing for a CA final examination, because only then you are watching these videos, right? So it is not only about law, it is about audit, it is about SFM, the formulas in SFM, the accountancy, the concepts, the accounting standards, the direct tax, the provisions, the case laws, indirect tax, most of all the ISCA, right? You have to mug up everything in ISCA, otherwise you don't score marks, you don't go with the understanding to write and score marks, right? So when you have all such things in head, why do you burden yourself with memorizing more things? It becomes difficult. So we will make an attempt, right, so that you know the rationale behind it, why and what is happening, so that in the examination, if you are getting a question and you don't remember what is there, then by your logic and by your rational thinking, you can know that, yes, these are the people who will be paid in priority to the rest, right? So we will make an attempt that you understand that, and once you do it, it becomes easier for you, right? So basically, what do we understand in the, or what is the concept that we will be taking up in today's lecture, is section 530, right? The preferential payment. When you don't have money or you don't have enough money, right, who are the people who need to be settled in priority? So they are basically covered under section 530, the preferential payment, right? Some of you who have already studied these concepts, they must be thinking, no, you have somebody before this also and that. Forget about everything. Keep one thing in mind, that when you are watching this lecture, right, empty your vessel, pour out all the knowledge that you have from your brain and listen and try to grab with a clean and fresh mind. Because it is only then when you will seep in things without conflict and they go straight into your brain. At the end of the lecture, okay, you try and analyze with whatever you have, you can do that, right? But before the lecture is over, because we go in a procedure, there may be something that I may skip and move on to the next thing and then come back to this, because there is a concept behind that, right? So don't try to bring in more thoughts into your brain, oh no, this is that and this and that, okay? Just listen to it with plain and clear mentality. This is an important topic. That is why I am discussing all of these. So, when you talk about preferential payment, I will not be discussing about preferential payment in today's lecture. I'll just give you the list of preferential payments so that you have it in the back of your mind, right? So here is the list on your screen. First, revenue, tax, cess, rates, all these things. So everything that you owe to the government, right? Whatever tax liabilities, right, whatever cess, whatever rates are applicable, whatever is it that you need to pay to the government, it is overdue or it is due or it is deferred, whatever it is, right, that has to be paid to the government in priority. Because if you are winding up, if you were not able to follow your company's business in a correct formality, in a correct order, and you have ended up in a pit where you need to be wound up and dissolved, your existence is coming to an end, then all those dues that you have to the government, that has accrued to the government, needs to be paid. Right? Then you have the wages, salaries to the employees. Because once you are gone, your employees are gone. And they will take some time to get employment somewhere else. Right? Because when they were here with an intent that, okay, we will work over here for life. It's a security for us. But now you're winding up. Where do they go? So for the time being, till they don't get the job, they need money. So please pay them first. Right? You have hired them, it's your liability. Next is the holiday remuneration to the employees. Even holiday remuneration to the employees are being added, because again, that is a payment to employee. They will need money. Employer's contribution, where you contribute to the PF and everything. Then you have employees' compensation. Then you have the funds that are due that you need to pay. And at the end, the investigation expenses. Right? We'll come in detail to these topics, right? But before that, these people are okay. They are priority. They need to be paid when you have the money. Right? So when now we will get back to some background. Right? So when the Companies Act 1956 came into play, right, then they identified these people to be in priority. They wanted these people to be paid the money first. And then when you have the surplus, you go on to pay the unsecured creditors and everything else. These people need to be paid in priority. These people have their right. Right, that is what Companies Act 1956 initially, right, they came up with. Then it carried on for a couple of years, right, a lot of years actually. Then finally, when you had the Companies Amendment Act 1985, right, in Companies Amendment Act 1985, section 529A was inserted. Right, so that Amendment Act inserted section 529A into the Companies Act 1956. And then they said that your workmen and your secured creditors need to be paid first. Workmen are not employees. They are the labor category people, basically. Right? They need to be paid in full. So we'll discuss what workmen are, what secured creditors are. But before that, we need to go to the provisions. We need to see what are the cases and when do they get the payment. And then we'll discuss about who they are. Right? So we are going back to some background and discussing about section 529A, overriding the preferential payment. So after so long period, 1956 to 1985, somewhere close to around 30 years, right, these people came into play that no, the workmen and the secured creditors, they need to be paid before anybody else, right? And when I talk about anybody else, we will refer to other acts as well, because now, for example, you have taken loans also from the bank and the financial institutions, right? And when you are going for winding up, you are not able to pay them as well. Because if you look at the list of priority over there, nowhere have we mentioned the bank and the financial institution. But you know, when you have dues from the bank, when you have loans taken from the bank, and if that bank or the financial institution, they approach the debt recovery tribunal, right, then you will have to pay their debts first. And there's an act for that, the Recovery of Debt Due to Banks and the Financial Institution Act 1993. So it did not exist when the Companies Act 1956 was taking form, when it was taking the shape, right? Long later, like around 35-40 years later, the concept of the Recovery of Debt Due to Bank and Financial Institution came up with the act in 1993. So that is why you had no reference to that in your Companies Act 1956. Okay with that? But as per that, you know that if they issue a certificate of recovery to the bank and the financial institution, then they come to you and you will have to settle it first. That is your priority. That becomes your priority. So forget about any other act. Forget about Companies Act 1956. Why? Because when your Companies Act 1956 was enacted, they never said that this would be a preferential payment, notwithstanding anything contained in the debt recovery provisions. Right? They did not override the debt recovery provisions. But when the debt recovery provisions came into play in 1993, they knew the provisions of the Companies Act 1956. And hence, they came up with the concept that they will override the Companies Act 1956. Right? They have issued the certificate of recovery, so they will have the right to recover. They will have the right to sell off their assets. So when a company is approached by any of the bank or the financial institution, right, understanding the concept, when they are approached by these people with the certificate of recovery, the company immediately will have to go ahead and sell off their assets and pay off their dues. Otherwise, they will be liable for other penalties as well. There will be proceeding initiated against them. That is why you will have to pay them in priority. But when even this concept came up, they valued and they respected the provisions contained in the Companies Amendment Act 1985. That was just around 7-8 years before this act. Right? So with that Amendment Act also, and overall, the overall concept that you finally conclude, we will not get into details of what happened in which act and what all those things, it will be very complicated for you. Just understand that the provisions of Section 529A is notwithstanding anything contained in Section 530 of the Companies Act 1956 and Section 90 of the Recovery of the Debts Due to Banks and Financial Institutions Act 1993. Okay, that means first priority Section 529A, then Section 19 in the other act, and then Section 530 in your Companies Act. Understanding there are a hell lot of things going on in between. Right? Don't be confused. Because try and understand one more thing, that the concept of the Recovery of Debt Due to Bank and Financial Institution Act 1993 is not in your syllabus. So you don't have to make reference to this act and to this procedure of debt recovery anywhere in your answers. That is not required of you being a CA final student, right? Because you are basically focused on the Companies Act, which is now 2013, focused on the Banking Regulation Act, IRDA, SEBI, insurance, and the other allied acts that have been specified, right? So this act of the recovery of debt due to bank and financial institution 1993 is not in your syllabus. So you don't have to make any reference to this act. But this is for your understanding, right? In the beginning of the lecture, what I told you is that we will go by the concept. You need to know everything. Because in future, if you are becoming a chartered accountant and you face a situation of recovery, or you face a situation of winding up, you will know what is happening in reality. Then if you see people paying off these things and priority to the rest, and you'll say, no. I have studied in Companies Act 2013. That these are not the preferential payment. Sorry, boss. You cannot pay off anybody else before this. That is the conflict, right? So you will have to know everything. That is what will help you understand even the questions in the examination. Just don't refer to this act, right? So what have you seen is that the most prevailing act, the overriding act or the overriding provision, is the provisions of Section 529, that they are overriding the preferential payment. That is the name of that section. Overriding preferential payments also, right? Now I will also discuss some of the cases with you, that how important is this, how powerful is Section 529A, right? Obviously we will not compete it with Section 530, because you know it's overriding. The provisions of this section itself say that it is notwithstanding anything contained in 530, right? But again, it is face to face, right? It is sword to sword in conflict with Section 19 of the debt recovery, right? So I'll give you a case. There was a debt or the loan taken from a bank, right? And the bank approached the debt recovery tribunal, arranged the certificate of recovery, and came back to the company. Listen, boss, this is the amount of loan that is due to me from you. So please pay them off. And the company, oh, you have the certificate of recovery, there is legal proceedings following that. Wait. And then they'll order and they'll seek for some people in the market and sell off one of their major assets, any land they had, any factory premise they had. They'll sell it off, whatever money they get, they'll try to pay off the recovery. They'll try to pay off the banks and the financial institution who has the certificate of recovery. Right? That is the priority. But if that company has entered the liquidation phase, if that company has entered the winding up phase, then Section 529A comes into play. Before winding up, whatever be the situation, the debt recovery will prevail. But after liquidation has started, after the liquidator has taken charge, may it be the official liquidator, may it be the provisional liquidator, anyone, after they have taken the charge, what happens is that they will override everything. So once the liquidation has taken place, even when the bank or the financial institution, they come up with that recovery certificate to you, that no, you owe this money to us, you will say, wait, let me settle my workmen and the secured creditors first, right? So Section 529 says that they will be settled in priority. Whatever asset you have, you will have to pay them off in full. And if you fall short of the asset, if you fall short of assets, you don't have money to pay them off in full as well, then you will pay them off proportionately, right? What proportion and everything, we'll be discussing it later. All you need to understand is that they have to be paid in full first. So consider a situation that bank has approached and there's no liquidation, so you pay off the bank, right? Or liquidation has started and then the bank approaches, that means you will pay off the secured creditors and the workmen. These things are very clear. Now consider a situation. The recovery certificate has been presented to you and you have started selling off the assets. You have started looking out for clients and you sold off one of your assets, right? But you did not yet get the money. No disbursement. No money was received. No money was disbursed. And within that period, when you sold the assets and everything is still in process, you are yet to get the money and everything, the company went into liquidation. Critical situation, right? That procedure for the debt recovery was already into process, but in between there is an obstruction that the company goes for winding up. The court has already given the winding up order and the liquidator is in office. Remember, your winding up proceedings have started, that okay, we are planning to wind up and there is a petition filed and the proceeding is going on. Those things are irrelevant. Unless and until the court has given the winding up order, we will not consider the winding up to have started, right? Or maybe the court has sent the provisional liquidator, whatever be the same, right? So once the winding up has started, the procedure of disbursement of the amount to the bank or the financial institution comes to a pause, comes to a halt. And then whatever money is recovered, asset was sold, money was yet to be recovered, now that money has come to the company, and the company cannot disburse it to the bank. They will have to pay off the workmen with that money, which they had actually intended to pay off the banks. They had sold their assets with an intention to clear off the debts due to the bank, right? But before disbursement, Section 529A comes into play. So you will have to put a halt on the disbursement to the bank and pay off whatever money you have to the workmen and the employee. And when the entire workmen and the workmen and the secured creditors, right, when they are settled, whatever surplus you have, give it to the bank. Or if you have more assets, sell off another asset and give it to the bank now. So now you understand how powerful is Section 529A, right? Because it is the legitimate claim of the workmen and the secured creditors, and they need to be paid off in full, in priority. And after they have been paid off, if you have any surplus money with you, then you go ahead with the rest of the thing, right? So we have some more text on the slide, which was, okay, RDD BFI Act, that is the Recovery of Debt Due to the Bank and the Financial Institution Act 1993, that issued the certificate of recovery to the bank and the financial institution. We have seen that. Section 529A protects the right of the legitimate claim of the workmen, right, which was introduced by the Companies Amendment Act 1985. And then we have also discussed the cases when the assets are sold to meet the payment due. Right? Clear with that concept? Now we can proceed with what the workmen dues are, who are the workmen, who are the secured creditors, and then moving ahead we'll go to the preferential payment and the rest of the things. Right? So since we have already had a lot of content in the lecture today, we'll start afresh, right, with your respective topic, picking up section 529, then 530, and step in the next lecture. Right? So until then, just seep it down into your head and understand. And remember one more thing, that the recovery of the debt due to the Bank and Financial Institution Act 1993 is not in your syllabus. Right? Even if you refer it into your examination, they don't deduct marks. But the point is, you don't have time. And the other risk is that the person who is checking it, maybe he has no idea about it. There is a possibility he has no idea about it. And then he says, he is writing about the debt recovery and stuff? Cross. It's a wrong answer. He won't even go through the registers of the answer. Act in 1993, but we are referring to 1956. Cross. So don't take that risk. Right? That is for your knowledge. That is for your understanding. And you know how powerful it is. You know the other situations as well. Because over here, we are not focused to prepare you for your exams only. Right? What we are focused with these lectures are to give you an insight of what is happening and what is the reality. Just reading the provisions and mugging up the points, okay, this will not fetch you anything in your future. You are giving in 5 years to your CA curriculum, right? From your IPC to CPT to your final and everything. You have done internship and all. Why do you do the internship? Because you need to learn over there. Otherwise, just mug up and give the examination. Right? Think you are sitting down, you are studying everything, and then that becomes a waste after you have qualified. It makes no point. It makes no sense, right? So if you're learning something, this is the time you can get into it. Because otherwise, and later in your life, you will never get into these provisions and understand. You will never get into it and read. Right? So you may think that yes, these lectures are taking a little time. So if you're very close to your examination, obviously these lectures are not very useful to you because you don't have a lot of time to go through all of these. But these are basically your content. That time you need something in summary. So we be rest assured, we will be coming up with summary lectures on each topic as well. Like we'll pick up a chapter, complete it in 2 to 3 lectures, next chapter, 2-3 lectures, next chapter, 2-3 lectures. That will be in short, without going to the background, without going to the concept, we will prepare you for the exams as well. Right? But until that, please focus on the larger goal. That is understanding and knowing what is happening. Right? So with that intent, let us be done with the lecture today. See you in the next lecture. We will be continuing with the provision and coming to your syllabus directly. Right? So until then, this is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Thank you and bye-bye.